morning. Let's bow in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I just want to praise you and thank you for this day. Thank you for the blessings that you've given us. Thanks for the freedom to be able to come here and freely worship you. I just ask that you open our hearts and our minds as we continue in worship to you. In Jesus' name. Other.
Okay. We're going to jump into some announcements. So give your final hugs, final handshakes. I still think greeting might be the best part of the service. So, you know, worship, greeting. Let's pray and go home, right? That's what we should do. I got a bunch of announcements I'm going to get through. So bear with me because I've got a full sheet scribbled and everything. So we might just do this, sing some songs, and go home today. No, we won't do that. Few things. I noticed Larry's here. Larry Tuxhorn's here. Praise the Lord. Glad you're back, Larry. All right, announcements. Ladies Lunch Bunch will be meeting on November 1st at 11:30 at the Epic Egg on 23rd Avenue in Greeley. Sign up in the foyer if you're going to Ladies Lunch Bunch. I assume you have to be a lady to go to that, but it sounds pretty good. So, ladies only, none of this new stuff. You have to be a biological woman to go to Ladies Lunch Bunch, okay? That's kind of a given, but just make it clear. So next Sunday, October 29th, there will be a Christian Ed meeting following the morning worship service. So anyone interested in helping, being a substitute teacher, being involved, so you can come to that. That's going to be October 29th, next Sunday, following the worship service. I envision they'll probably just meet in the foyer. So if you're interested or you've been thinking, you know, I might be able to teach class, be involved in some Sunday school, this would be a good time for that. Where's Jim Cross at? There he is. So he's been doing our Wednesday night Bible study since Dennis left, and they finished up their topic. So thanks, Jim, first of all, for doing the Wednesday night Bible study for as long as you have. But because he's finished, we're going to kind of take a little hiatus and let Ray get here and figure out what we're going to do. So no Wednesday night Bible study until we announce it, which will be pretty quick. But I just want you to know not to show up on Wednesday until we tell you, okay? So that's where I'm going to kind of leave it at this point. No Wednesday Bible study until after Ray gets here. Clothing bank is in need of winter items. We must have a lot of the short sleeve stuff, but we kind of need to get some of the colder weather stuff. So if you have winter items you're clearing out, now's the time to bring them up to the church so the clothing bank can get those ready to go for when we have our next food bank and clothing bank day. Couples Connect is actually going to meet on Friday, October 27th, right? So this coming Friday, right here at the church, we're going to meet. So Couples Connect is going to be doing that. Now, I did get an update this morning from Ray, and they're kind of in the process of moving this direction, and they've got two huge, I think they were 27-foot pod trailers with their stuff in it that are going to be coming and being dropped off on the 30th, and they are saying, anybody that is willing to help unload some trailers, we would be up for any help. So what I did is I put a sign-up sheet on this side, line, name, phone number. If you're willing, I don't know the exact date and time. When you're moving, things seem to change. They mentioned the 30th, but I'm kind of not sure of the time. If you're just willing to come and help unload, help them with that, put your name and your phone number on that sign up, and that way we can get a text or a call to you and just let you know if you can make it. I got a sign up out there for anybody who's willing to come and just help them get unloaded and situated. So that's in the foyer regarding that. And he'll be here next Sunday sharing in the service. So it's coming right up. A message from Andrew Shaw. He's kind of the guy to talk to. He's working on snow patrol is what we're calling it. Guys, to help shovel the snow at the church here as the winter is coming in. So he's got a sign up in the foyer if you're interested on this side, Andrew. If you're interested, it's over here. Sign up. Maybe you come help shovel, just get things prepared during the week, during Sunday mornings. And if you have questions, Andrew's in the sound booth. He's usually up here after the service, but you can catch Andrew if you have questions in regards to that. I think I've got through all my announcements. So I'm going to turn it over to Daryl. He has a quick announcement.
It's my pleasure in the absence of Glenn to present to Scott and Ronnie the appreciation gift that the church has put together. So I'd like Scott, Melissa, Judah, Ethan to come on up, Ronnie, Jessica, and John. And I was looking over the crowd for Ronnie, but he's not here. Oh, okay. So, might be a baby. And Linda's already tried to recruit a Mary and baby Jesus. Already tried with Jessica on John, and it didn't work out because she was not wanting to do that. So I don't know that we can talk her into it, but we're looking for a baby Jesus. Cantata's coming up. So a waiting list? We couldn't even think of too many that are going to be here with us in the near future, so. My wife will appreciate the advertisement for that, I hope. I haven't got myself in trouble yet. Okay. So on behalf of the Kersey Community Church, we'd like to present Scott and Melissa and Judah and Ethan with this for the appreciation of your ministry here. Okay, we'll call Bruce up then to lead the hymns.
Good morning, everybody. Would y'all please stand for our first hymn? It's a beautiful old hymn, Wonderful Words of Life, and we'll do all three verses. Please be seated, and the men will come forward for the morning offering.
Let's pray for the offering. Father in heaven, just want to thank you for another amazing Sunday to be here to worship you, and thank you for everything you give to us, and now we will give you back a portion which is rightfully yours. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Ladies, thank you for that beautiful rendition of What a Friend We Have in Jesus. That was beautiful. Would you please stand and remain standing for the doxology and the hymn to following? Children are now released for Children's Church, and we're now going to sing all three verses of All the Way My Savior Leads Me.
Thank you.
Please be seated and thank you for that beautiful music.
Thanks, Bruce, again for leading our songs. We have a lot of music in our service, and it's wonderful to have the variety that we have of musicians and instrumentalists, singers, so that's a blessing here. You know, I can't forget about the choir. Last week, who was here last week, and we got to hear, you know, Joshua fit the Battle of Jericho, okay? So I'm sitting in my office this week working on our sermon, and I hear this, Joshua fit the battle of, and I'm like, what is... And Judah is playing Legos, singing the choir song. So never discount your music ministry because it's what sticks during the week. Who goes home and they're usually got one of the songs somehow cycling through their head? It happens at all ages. Today's an important day. And I'm going to say that, you know, I've been able to spend about 6 months with you doing messages. And I would hope that you took something from all those messages, but today might be the most important one given the context of where we are, okay? And so that's where we're going to go today in a totally different direction, but an important one. But let's pray before we start. God, we come before you today. We're just thankful for this church. We're thankful for how you have led this church and how you have taken care of it and how you've grown it and how you've bless the people here, and you have fed us. And we pray, Lord, as we transition, and Ray and Michelle coming, we just pray, Lord, that you would continue to do that, that this is your church. You'll have your way with it, and you will lead us along the way. We thank you again for the time we can spend in your word today, and we pray this in your name. Amen. So we've come to a kind of a transition point in history of our congregation. You probably knew it was coming. Lots of changes here at Kersey Community over the last 6 months. Some been a little tough, some have been encouraging. But that's how transitions and changes work, isn't it? You have both. See, we like it when things are going along in a expected and a predictable manner. I know I like it that way. I don't know about you guys. But when you throw humans into the unknown, it's pretty hard for us. It really is. Some panic, you know, some become afraid, some freeze up, you know, they can't move one way or the other, and some try to escape. But we all deal with the unknown before us in different ways. So 6 months ago, almost to the day, Pastor Dennis called me in and he told me that he was going to be leaving the church. But this last 6 months has taught me a few things that I want to share with you this morning. As we prepare for the future, the transition going forward together. So we're going to look at 1 Corinthians chapter 12 to start with today. Let's look beginning at verse 12. It says, "For just as the body is one, has many members, but all the members of the body, although they are many, are one body, thus also Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free persons, and all were made to drink one Spirit, for the body is not one member, but many." Underline that last sentence. This church here in Kersey is a body of individuals who have determined to do something individually and together for a purpose. We have determined to come to seek after, worship, and serve Christ. Period. That's what this place and this gathering should be all about every day of the week, every Sunday. Jesus is the cord that runs through this congregation and keeps it together. Don't forget that. He's also what we should emphasize at all times, and the one in which we should seek to glorify above anything or anyone else. Church these days can quickly, especially in the Western church, turn into something very different than that. It turns into emphasizing us individually. Me, 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 right? Church many times becomes sort of like a buffet where we eat the food we like until the menu changes, and then we just go to a different buffet. And that has happened a lot in the history of the church, not just Kersey, but in the big church. I can still remember the day when I was in college and a professor told me that there were over 39,000 denominations of Christianity. Did you know that? My jaw hit the floor when I heard it, and then my stomach began to feel sick as I realized Christ desired his body to be united. But 39,000 groups all claiming to be the right way to do things seems to be anything but united. Would you agree? I'll go out on a limb here and guess that most of these dividing moments where one church split into two was over change. Now, I'll be honest with you all, my biggest fear as we've walked down this road together for the last 6 months has been that the devil try to do anything to rip this body apart. He's hit me with that. Maybe some of you with that. You know, sometimes we forget our focus in church, especially during times of transition. We forget. But it's important for us to remember our purpose from God's perspective has not changed. Our commission is still the great one. It's to go and to make disciples of all the nations. That hasn't changed. We are all important and critical parts in that mission in this body. We have people from every walk of life, it seems like here. Lots of different paths of life. We've got retired folks. We've got business owners. We've got kids. We've got young couples, young families. We've got anything you can think of. Mechanics, you name it. We have people who have walked through illness, tragedy, heartbreaks, job losses, some that have had wonderful triumphs, wonderful blessings, and everything in between those two extremes. And all of you, all of us, are in a place where we can still make disciples of Christ. That's what we're supposed to be doing. Paul says in verse 27 of chapter 12 in 1 Corinthians, he says, "Now you are the body of Christ and members of it individually." See, the body of Christ is not to be situated or identified with one human being in our church. Not Ray, not me, not you, but rather on Christ alone. He, by his redemption of our souls, and the purchase of our lives with his blood has allowed us and invited us to his body and his work and his family. It's not Scott's or Dennis's or Ray's. It's Christ's family. I share this reminder with you this morning so that we can get our minds set on the right track and our hearts on the right track as to welcome Ray next week. One thing I heard early on in this process that really stuck with me, and really now makes a lot of sense as I've thought about things, was when a believing friend in this body asked the question of what we as the body here in Kersey are supposed to be for the new pastor, as opposed to what he is supposed to be for us. You see, we get backwards many times when we see a new pastor transition happen. We start to think about his service to us, and we forget about our service to him as well, spiritually. Think of this for a moment. You've been in this church for any period of time. You're probably comfortable being here. I would hope you are this morning. You're comfortable coming. You're comfortable sitting where you sit. Comfortable, hopefully, with the people around you, or you've probably moved. You're comfortable greeting who you greet. Right? If you're new here, I really do hope that you land in that mindset at some point, that you will be comfortable in that way. But we are the ones who have so much responsibility as Christ's body in this transition. Do you realize that? We are the ones who have become parts of this body, Christ's body in Kersey, and therefore we know it better, we understand it better than anyone that hasn't been here. And that means we have an opportunity to act like a mature body of Christ, which welcomes in optimism and encouragement and hospitality and love and patience. When it comes to preference, we may have to adjust a little. Not acting like our personal wants are somehow moral truths that they just can't be changed. We typically read the love chapter of 1 Corinthians at weddings. Did anybody have that read at their wedding? Probably a lot of people. We think of it from a very broad view. We apply this chapter in 1 Corinthians to those things about love and the things that represent love the most, because it's the love chapter, right? But are you aware that if you take out all of the chapter numbers and the titles and the notes in our Bibles that separate these chapters and texts, you'll find that Paul was talking about the church. He was talking about the church. Chapter 12 of 1 Corinthians is about the church. He's going over the gifts, about the abilities, about the positions, the importance of different people in the greater body of Christ. And he goes into the gifts people have been given by God, their individual abilities and contributions to that body. Now, I'm going to read to you some text from 1 Corinthians 12 and 13, and I'm going to take out all the lines and the breaks. And I just want you to follow along and listen to this. Now, you are the body of Christ and members of it individually, in whom God has appointed to the church. First, apostles, second, prophets, third, teachers, then miracles, then gifts of healing, helps, ministrations, kinds of tongues. Not all are apostles, are they? Not all are prophets, are they? Not all are teachers, are they? Not all are workers of miracles, are they? Not all have the gifts of healing, do they? Not all speak with tongues, do they? Not all interpret, do they? But strive for the greater gifts, and I will show you a still more excellent way. If I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but do not have love, I have become a ringing brass gong or a clashing cymbal. And if I have the gift of prophecy and I know all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so that I can remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. And if I parcel out all my possessions, and if I hand over my body in order that it will be burned, but do not have love, it benefits me nothing. Love is patient, love is kind, love is not jealous, it does not boast, it does not become conceited, it does not behave dishonorably, it is not selfish, it does not become angry, it does not keep a record of wrongs, it does not rejoice at unrighteousness, but rejoices with the truth, bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. Paul's talking about the church, folks. The concepts of love are far-reaching into marriage and relationships, of course, but the context of this chapter in the greater book is for the body of Christ to recognize something extremely important, that it's not about me, it's about Christ and showing his love to people for his purposes. In 1 Corinthians 12, 31, Paul says, "But strive for the greater gifts, and I will show you a still more excellent way." We are here today to use our gifts and our abilities to serve this body together and minister to one another in love. We are here to worship and grow in the Word of God together in love. All of these things are critical to our growth as individuals and a body. But we must not, in the midst of these things, neglect our defining attribute of Christ's body, love for one another. Paul famously said in 1 Corinthians 13:13, "And now these three things remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is what? Love. Love." We have an opportunity before us this morning, together as Christ's body. Will we commit ourselves to loving Ray and Michelle in this manner? I can tell you this, it blows my mind to think of leaving a church that became my home to move across the country to a place I've never known, to come to a people I don't know, putting myself and my future in their hands. Now, some people might call that decision crazy. But when you believe that God has asked you to do something, it's not crazy, it's called. And you're putting everything in the hands of God when you make a step like that. Knowing the future is unknown. The one thing we don't like, one thing we need to do is make this church body, this place, this transition, an opportunity to, as Paul said, express the love in the body of Christ. I'll say this again and again. This body here in Kersey is the most loving and giving body I have ever seen. The ways that you take care of me, you encourage me and support me, it is unmatched, unmatched, no question. I want Ray to get to experience that. I really do. We have an opportunity this morning in the coming weeks to help Ray grow in a way he never has. We can grow his faith as a body like he's never experienced. To steal a line from JFK and change it just a little bit, ask not what your church can do for you, but what you can do for your church. What in love can we do for Christ, for each other, for Ray and Michelle as they come? What can we do? I want to just give you three things as we conclude our time together that I believe are critical for dealing with this type of church transition. Three brief things. First, be optimistic, not pessimistic. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 13:7, now remember, it's about the church body, right? He says that love hopes all things. What's your mindset going into next week and the future here at Kersey? Are you optimistic or pessimistic? This might be bold, but I don't think the body of Christ should be looked at expecting the worst. This is Christ's body, folks. He's in control of it. Its members, its functions. He really can do with it whatever he wants, including allow unknowns into it, which he has, including allowing changes to it, which he will. Do we trust that God is at the control levers of this body, or do we really think that he'll abandon what he has purchased with his own blood? We will have things we'll learn, things we'll need to address, but those are opportunities for the Lord to craft this body together, not rip it apart. I am hopeful for this body because I know although it's made up of sinners like me, at the head of it is a God who is perfect. That takes a lot of weight off me, thankfully, and Ray. And although, as Isaiah said in Isaiah 55:8, for my thoughts are not your thoughts and your ways are not my ways, I have enough evidence to know that what is before me that is unknown and new is also fully known by him whose body this is. Are you optimistic and ready to act on that optimism in order to see the furtherance and growth of this body going forward? Our willingness to be optimistic and hopeful will be critical to success in the future here at the Kersey Church. Secondly, we need to take care of each other. 1 Corinthians 13:4 through 5 says, love is patient, love is kind, love is not jealous, it does not boast, it does not become conceited, it does not behave dishonorably, it is not selfish, it does not become angry, it does not keep a record of wrongs. This is the guide and outline for how we should interact with one another in the body of Christ. As we receive a new body part of sorts, these things are going to be critical if we want this body to work and grow together properly. We need to be patient and kind and selfless to one another. Transitions are hard because new people do new things. Did you know that? They act and approach things differently than we are used to. We need to be willing to step back and be patient and kind, not angry and selfish. When you think of a human body for a moment, it's made up of many parts. In fact, that's the analogy and the illustration that Paul uses for the church. But if you have something happen and you need to replace a certain body part, maybe a knee replacement, hip replacement, maybe something as major as a heart transplant, the doctors are going to make sure, they're going to want to make sure that the rest of your body is healthy before they do the surgery, aren't they? They don't want you to have an illness or infection because they know when they put this new part in, that infection or illness could have devastating impacts on the body receiving that new part. The body needs to be prepared, it needs to be healthy, it needs to be ready for this new part to come. And our church is no different. Just like that patient going home after the operation, Christ wants his body working together, full power together, in healing and growing and receiving that new part. And right now, in our hearts and minds, we can prepare this body for the new part. Take care of each other. Encourage one another. Stay together with one another. Over the course of these last 6 months, I've talked with many of you who have told me the same thing. This is my church body. This is the body that I'm a part of. This is the time when we all, myself included, need your critical part in this body to pull in close so together we can receive the new part successfully. You think of that patient who received that new part. 10 years down the road, they could be running a marathon if their body receives that new part. Yet if the body rejects it, the whole thing could become ineffective and dysfunctional. Let's make a commitment to take care of each other, to help each other, even lovingly guide and correct each other if we need to in the midst of the new transitions. This will prepare this body for Ray and Michelle, and it will keep us together going forward. And finally, this is the most important thing. Hold fast to the gospel of Christ. Our mission here is not to build buildings and to grow programs. Those things will happen when we are focused on what's most important. Matthew 6:33, but seek first his kingdom and righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Jesus spoke these words when speaking about, what do you know, anxiousness in the unknown. The unsure nature that is tomorrow brings about this type of stuff. But his instruction in the face of unknowns was to focus on what was first. Regardless of what comes, our church is to be first and foremost united in this here at Kersey. Seeking God, holding fast to his word and his work. That is priority number one. That's something we all individually first and then together as a church need to be pursuing and have right at the top. Christ is the head of his church and therefore all eyes on him. My role might be to teach. Ray's role might be to shepherd and teach, but we are no greater or lesser than any of you in this body. Your gifts and abilities are first to be offered to Christ, and through that you'll reach others in this body with them. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 4 says, there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are varieties of ministries, but the same Lord, and there are varieties of activities, but the same God who works all things in all people. But to each one is given the manifestation of the Spirit for what is beneficial to all. We must not discount the power and importance of each other and what we have to offer this body individually and together in Christ. We must not forget that we are here in this body today for a reason. And some of that reason might just be to grow and love Pastor Ray and Michelle, showing them what a body of believers who love the Lord and love each other actually looks like. I've enjoyed every week that I've been able to share with you all. It's the joy of my heart to share with you what God has taught me with his word and through his people. If I've stepped on toes or convicted your heart over the last 6 months, it's because I experienced it first. If I informed and helped you grow in the knowledge of God's word, it's because someone taught me and grew me in that knowledge first. You've all taught me as much, if not more, than I've taught you in ways I couldn't read or study in a book. So please don't discount your ministry here. Please don't. To the pastor, to the leaders, because this is the body. Okay, no more crying. We got to stop that. I just want to leave you with this today. These words of Paul. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 14. For the body is not one member, but many. If the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I'm not part of the body. Not because of this, is it not a part of the body? And if the ear should say, because I'm not an eye, I am not part of the body. Not because of this, it is not a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would be the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? But now God has placed the members, each one of them, in the body just as he wanted. And if they all were one member, where would the body be? But now there are many members, but one body. Now the eye is not able to say to the hand, I do not have need of you. Or again, the head to the feet, I do not have need of you. But by much more, the members of the body which are thought to be weaker are necessary. And the parts of the body which we think to be less honorable, these we clothe with more abundant honor. And our unpresentable parts come to have more abundant presentability. But our presentable parts do not have need of this. Yet God composed the body by giving more abundant honor to the part which lacked it, in order that there not be a division in the body, but the members would have the same concern for one another. And if one member suffers, all the members suffer together. If a member is honored, all the members rejoice with it. Now you are the body of Christ and members of it individually, and whom God has appointed in the church. Be optimistic. Care for each other. Hold fast to the gospel of Christ. Amen? Let's pray. God, we just again thank you for your word and how it instructs us in so many things as a body, as individuals. And so as we step forward into next week with Pastor Ray and Michelle coming, we pray that you would guide us, you would direct us, encourage us, help us. We pray for them as they start this journey. You would guide them and direct them, speak to them, and that this body of yours would remain solid because you are at the head and we seek you first. We thank you again for today and our time. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Scott, we love you and
are very safe. Before we do these last two songs, let's close in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I just want to praise you and thank you again. And I ask that you help us to all boldly go out and be Christ in the sphere of influence that we personally live in. Just ask that you bless our time this coming week, and I ask that you be with us as we continue to worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Have a great week.